Maybe.
Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, here we are at the Holts booth as every year, and probably this is the most interesting part of the whole IWA show for the historic shooters and collectors and stuff, just like us. I'm here with Simon, my good old friend. He's the one who helps me to select the guns from Holts, and I have to say that all the guns that I bought from him are very, very good shooters, so I'm a happy guy, a happy customer, thank you very much.
Good news.
That's why we would like to make some promotion for Holts, because you really find some good value in their next auction. So Simon, please tell me something about how developed you are regarding your catalogs and your internet presence.
Absolutely, no problem at all. Well, of course, many people are familiar with the traditional Holts paperback or hardback catalog, but of course, this is arriving only just before the auction, and it has cost of postage, etc., etc. So if you can't wait for the catalog, we now produce it in a version for the iPad, for the Android, and it's available for download. But more importantly, it's for free. And once you've downloaded it once, we send it to you every 3 months.
No. But it's really an excellent source of information, and not just a good way to select what you are going to bid for, or if you want to visit Holts, then you can already get some information about the guns. But from the historical point of view, they are excellent information.
And every catalog you download stays on the iPhone or the iPad or the iProduct, so you can complete the collection for every catalog. So if you're with friends, you can show them what you're getting. You can zoom in. It's possible to look at the engraving.
Yeah.
Many things.
Yeah. I mean, the pictures that you upload are just beautiful.
Perfect.
Just beautiful.
Yeah. But the other thing is, of course, is with it being on this product, it doesn't have to be connected to the internet. So whether you're on the top of a mountain, underground on the train, you can still be in contact with Holts.
Yeah. Thank you very much, sir.
No problem. Thank you.
Thanks.
This is a Piper's Patent Volley Rifle, also known as the Mitchell's.
I know you don't want to carry that big catalogue around.
Immediately recognisable by seven holes in the end.
And this is a 22 calibre, if I see.
This is a 22 calibre. I believe these were only ever made in 22 rimfire. And it was a professional hunter's rifle. This particular one has retained its original charger. That was loaded with seven individual cartridges and dropped into the breech in the same fashion as a speed loader, maybe for a revolver. Mm-hmm. And then obviously the breech shut. It's very similar to the Remington rolling block action, but it fires all seven cartridges together. And it was primarily designed for larger waterfowl, actually on the water, so things like geese and birds like that. When you didn't want to miss, when it was important that you had something to take to market to sell, because these guns were bought by people who were hunting for money, not necessarily for the...
Yeah, not for the elegance of the
means. Yeah, not for the end result as such. It was the money they wanted at the end.
And the barrels are rifled?
The barrels are rifled. Unfortunately, this is missing its rear sight, but obviously with seven shots going in the same direction, it was unlikely you were going to miss. Very, very, very expensive gun when it was new. When this was new in around about 1890, that sort of date, it actually cost more than a Best Purdy side lock ejector. So it was one of the most expensive guns that money could buy at the time. And not many were made, really. Probably less than 500, something like that.
Can I hand it?
Yeah, please.
And it's not heavy.
No, not at all. No,
you'd think, very good balance.
You'd think it would be.
You think you will pull you over. And this is something that can easily.
Yeah, it's
easily
very rare. The only other one that I've ever had, the charger was a reproduced one by a gunsmith. It wasn't. Need to point him at the ground, really. That's him.
Yeah.
It was a one made by a gunsmith, because they are easily lost.
Cool. Not bad at all. I really thought it would be much heavier.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you think it's all holes, really.
Yeah.
The largest caliber that Adams made a revolving 58. Rifle.
65. 65.
Wow.
Adams revolver rifle.
They actually made a handful of actual revolvers in this caliber as well. I've actually seen one of the revolvers. There's supposed to only be two known in the world now.
And it's double action.
Yeah, only, because it has a concealed hammer.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
Very good. Thank you.
It's needed. Yeah.
But as revolving rifles go, exactly. It's an absolute monster.
Look at the expert sight. Or something like that. No, it's not on the side.
You used to.
100 yards, 200 yards, 300 yards. And was it loaded with the conical bullet or round bullet?
It would take either. I mean, there's no mould with this one, but they came with an Adams patent mould with a conical and a ball.
Yeah,
so
yeah,
you could shoot either. But unlike the Colt, for argument's sake, Adams realised that there was a danger of losing your hand when you fired these sort of guns.
So that's why
he made it to use the continental back hold. So the blast was in front of your hand. Mr. Colt never did that. Very rare, again, only a couple known. Lots of Adams revolving rifles, but not this size.
Every year.
Very cool.
This is our problem.
Right, this is a Needham's patent needle fire shotgun. Immediately you see it, you think of the Dreyes. The Dreyes needle fire was almost identical in every respect. Obviously, the cartridge is loaded into the breech. Breeches are shut and they screw down. You have cocking pieces on the side, and then a double trigger and a conventional shotgun. These actually sold quite well in the UK, as did the Dreyes version of the same thing. But what's nice about this one is a very high quality version, much engraving, and the condition is very, very good. And so many got converted just to ordinary centerfire and ruined in my eyes, of course. Right up. Take him right up. Right to the top.
Top, I see. I see. Well, one thing for sure that the Dreyse had a much longer pin.
Yeah.
This one is quite short, so.
Yeah. Was made by Rigby, and it's a needle fire single shot rifle, also copied and manufactured in Belgium as well, but the Belgian ones don't tend to have the wood forend, they tend to have the metal forend. Again, very rarely found in good condition. Many of them got converted to shotguns at a later date, and again ruined.
And why it is needle fire? I see that the firing pin is quite short.
Well, it's not when it's all the way forwards.
This is something like the chassepot action when the percussion cap must be on the.
But back it takes of still takes a paper cartridge with an obturator. Yeah.
The Dreyse, the pin that
goes all the way, almost hits the back of the bullet. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. In this case, it's easier. Very cool.
But still,
look at this breech closing.
Yeah.
Look at how the breech closes.
It's almost like a screw breech.
Yeah.
And then this for taking the firing pin out, because obviously they eroded away quickly.
Very cool. Very cool. I could buy it for my son.
It's lovely, isn't it, really?
Yeah.
Okay, this is a Gayes patent, G-H-A-Y-E-S. He was a Belgian gunsmith, worked in Liège. This is serial number 5. This is actually the fifth gun made by him, or sold by him anyway. Most Gayes patents that you see are made under license by other gunsmiths. Mm-hmm. You don't see so many with his name actually on all parts. You'll often see the stamp on the lever, because this was the registration from him. But other than that, Coxwell and Harrison in England, for instance, made a lot of these. Quite a nice quality with the gold inlay. He was obviously quite proud of this one.
Very nice. And the cartridge that was loaded was a pin fire
12
cartridge.
Bore pin fire. Yeah. I have also seen them where the hammers have recesses underneath. Yeah. So when they drop on the pins and then you slide them forwards, it pulls the shells out. But this one doesn't have.
Excellent.
He'd obviously not thought of that at this point.
It's obvious because the barrel's moving forward.
Yeah.
Very good.
This is actually a very rare one because it's a 577 Whitworth, not a 451 Whitworth.
That's very rare.
It's an experimental.
You should have seen me.
But to the untrained eye, of course, it looks like all the others. Yeah. But so you really know what's different. I know what's different.
ladies and gentlemen, this is where it all began. So this is one of the very first pieces that we first used for testing the rifle.
Yeah, for the Patton 1853 trials.
Do we know that what is the twist rate of this rifle? It's also 120 or?
No, I mean, unfortunately, I don't. We believe it is one of the ones submitted for the trials of the 1853 Patton, which was obviously after the mini rifle trials. Mm-hmm. But in 577 as opposed to 451, which of course 99% of Whitworths were made in.
Yeah.
So very unusual. Yeah. Very unusual.
Well, I'm pretty sure that this one has a very high perceived value. So
it should have. It should have. Yeah. Yeah, they don't turn up very often. I mean, maybe only 20 guns made. So very unusual.
Yeah. Oh, this is a rifle.
this
is a bull rifle.
This is what's known as your tiger's worst nightmare.
So this is actually a hunting rifle. So
this is a yeah. This is a, this. So the legend has it, this particular rifle was made for a British officer in the Indian Army. Mm-hmm. It was locally made from other parts from other rifles, and he used it for sniping tigers off the top of the fort where his unit was based in, which is why it has these special match sights. But the lock has come off an older Brown Bess. You can see where the original loops were on the bottom of the rifle. This barrel's been turned through 90 degrees and the loops repositioned. The stock made in the English style, but probably locally in India, but quality, very heavy.
So probably this is one of the very few war guns that are civilian guns.
Yeah.
I didn't realise it was rifle program.
Yeah, oh yeah.
It's amazing.
It's a tiger rifle. It's for tiger.
It's a big game.
Dangerous game. Well, when you're stood on the top of a fort, nothing's dangerous. Unless it's an eagle.
It's stable.
Yeah, carefully. His blood pressure is going up.
Yes, this is more like.
Oh, I think it weighs 26 pounds. But he was a match rifle shooter, which is why he's copied.
Yeah, yeah, I see.
He's actually copied the match setup.
One thing for sure that I'm not going to change my free rifle for this one. MLAIC matches.
But it's
very cool.
Okay.
And there's a gun to break your shoulders.
Well, this one's not too bad.
Yeah, because the caliber is smaller.
Yeah, it's still rifled. Mm-hmm. And if this serves exactly the same purpose as the Piper's patent. Mm-hmm. This was a gun for a professional hunter. Only in this case, he was shooting deer, not geese. Mm-hmm. But they are still called goose rifles, mm-hmm. probably because of those, not because that's what they were originally made for.
So the terminology is goose rifle.
Yeah. Yeah.
What is the caliber of the bores?
They're around about 44 sort of caliber. We would call it a sort of 54 bore, that sort of size. Yeah, yeah. But again, obviously all discharging simultaneously. Got a double range sight. I mean, this is pretty much as state of the art as a flintlock can get. You've got a roller bearing. Waterproof pans. Yeah. You've got drains either side if you're out in the rain.
Guys, we see us.
Oh, this is good.
And obviously, this was a Nock patent. It's best known for the Navy rifle that they made for the British Navy, which was much larger than this. And
what was the caliber of the Navy rifles?
650.
And they were.
I'm lying to you. 550. They did make some in 650, but they weren't manageable.
Yeah. And rifle bore as well.
No, they were smooth bore. They were smooth bore. This one really wanted to shoot all seven in a straight line. Didn't want to spread them. Whereas the The actual Navy one had actually a little bit of inbuilt inaccuracy for that for effect. You got him?
Yeah. And it's not heavy either.
No.
Absolutely.
No. I mean, the recoil's sharp, but it's not unmanageable.
Not good at all.
No.
Not good at all.
Quite. Same caliber, but this one is still in its original condition, if you like. It's not been renovated or anything like that.
What is the time frame difference between the two?
About 45 years. Mm-hmm. This one was made around about 1835.
Same family, it's a Nock as well.
Yes, made by but a different family member. Yeah.
Beautiful. Folding rear sight as well.
Yeah, a little tiny double leaf.
50, 100, 150.
No, 50. I like these things. 100, 150.
Looks better though.
It
hasn't got a full side backside,
does
it?
No.
Yeah, it has.
Seven.
Got
it. Standard 45. It's British. 54.
That's actually probably a rarer gun.
Funny enough, that's the one I've got, not that one.
Oh, really? Oh, right, okay.
So, ladies and gentlemen, we are at the Holts booth, and we are very lucky because we have Don Dallas here, who is the writer of excellent firearms history books, like his latest book, the book about Alexander Henry, a very important and famous rifle maker in Edinburgh. So, Don, what actually are you working on now? So.
Well, I'm actually working on a very, very different book just now. I've written 11 books primarily on the history of British gun makers, but Nick Holt of Holts Auctioneers has asked me to write a very, very different book, and this book is on what British gun makers are doing today, what they can actually offer to the world. So my latest book, which I don't have a title for just quite yet, is going to be on about 12 or 14 gun makers in Great Britain who are actually manufacturing really, really top quality guns purely built in Britain, just to showcase to the world how British gun making is very, very much alive and well, and is actually probably leading the world in best quality gun and rifle manufacture.
And I have to say, I already have your book and it's not signed, so you have to do something.
I'd be delighted to sign it for you. Delighted.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Actually, no, the British firearms making industry and culture is something that developed for centuries, and it did invest a lot of value into all the European and American firearms makers, and Don Dallas is researching this, so we are quite grateful. And if you like to know more about the British firearms makers, like check there, Holland, Purdy, Henry, and which was the fourth book? Dickinson.
John Dixon.
Yeah. You must buy his books. Excellent, excellent source of information.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Thank you very much, Tom, for your work. It's now recording.
Oh, Jesus Christ.
Oh, shit. Very, very rare. They didn't make many of this. This is a Whitworth Rook rifle. Let me just... I won't push it all the way because it's quite tight. We have all the sights and everything as well for it.
It has a ladder sight, the long range sight.
Yeah, it's got the proper ladder sight and everything with it.
What a beautiful!
No,
what a beauty!
And a little miniature target foresight. Yeah. I mean, it's like a little baby match rifle, but it is actually a rook rifle.
Why is it called rook rifle? Because it's for
It was for shooting rooks.
Really?
No other reason. Really? Yeah, I mean that all those small bore single shot rifles that we call rook rifles in England were bought for shooting rabbits and rooks. Uh-huh. We didn't care where the bullet came down. You fire it up there and it kills someone in the village half a mile away. It doesn't matter. Those days were different.
It's a collateral damage, I guess.
Collateral damage, yeah. If you were the lord of the manor, it didn't really matter.
Check this beauty. It's like the long range rifles of the great matches, the 1,000 yards, just smaller.
Yeah.
Very nice.
Very nice.
But again, the condition is wonderful.
Yeah.
Absolutely wonderful.
I love it.
I think, I mean, until the two Nock volley guns turned up, this was my favourite thing in the sale. And then the Nock volley guns came along and I thought, ooh, you know, I can't decide.
Look at the board.